This is indeed a nation blessed of God. I'm delighted that I can come back to you after we are taking a short break for about a month. I know that many people have been inquiring, why are we not having the program? And so we have been overwhelmed with people who have expressed that the program has been a part of their life, and we ask them to consider, reconsider. And so we decide that we, in the best interest of the nation, we will actually resume our program, and I'm sure that you will actually enjoy today's resumption of our program. It is still a nation blessed of God. We became very aware of the fact that there are so many people in our nation who are looking for a way out, looking for change, who are looking for an answer, and who are appreciative of a voice that dare to be speaking the facts as they are, that dare not to compromise the word of God. And we are humbled by the fact that people who have met me and some of them who have called in have been saying that this is the voice, not necessarily El Monte's voice, but the voice of the message, the tenor of the message they're talking about, to bring the nation to a realization that we need to come back to God. And beloved, what inspired this program from the very beginning, for the years we have been in the air, a nation blessed of God, is because of the word of the Lord, that God is still bent on blessing any nation. Jesus Christ told the disciples, his last word to them was, or I should say his last command to them was, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. So the gospel is what the world needs to hear. And then in Matthew he says, go and make disciples of all nations, teaching them to observe the things I command you. So God the Father and Jesus Christ his Son, they are both nationally convicted and nationally concerned, and they are nationally oriented. And Trinidad and Tobago is not different, because we are a nation. And the Bible declares that God's hand is stretched over any nation that will dare walk in the path that he has given them to bring blessing and to bring prosperity and to bring security. And we must understand that we are not a coincidental nation. We are among the nations of the earth. And before we ever were on the earth, God had intended that he has his desire to interact with nations. When God called Abraham and told him what his plans for the future were, God said to Abraham, among other things, I am going to bless you. I'm going to use you as the catalyst. Now I'm paraphrasing here. And I'm going to use you, and through your life and your seed that will issue out of your loins, the nations of the earth will be blessed. The nations of the earth. And because I am so very convinced, beloved, that God will not go back upon his word. He himself declares, as the rains come down from the heavens and return not hither, but water the earth and give fruit or food to the eater, and seed to the sower. He says, so shall the words be that go out of my mouth, they shall not return void. But the word that goes out of my mouth, it will prosper. It will accomplish the thing wherein I sent it, and prosper in the thing wherein I please. What I deduce from that, and by the way, Isaiah chapter 55, is this. God is saying through the instrumentality of Isaiah, irrespective of the environment upon the earth, irrespective of what takes place in a nation, whatever comes out of God's mouth concerning nation per se, it will come to pass. Many times we have the idea, because of the wickedness of men and because of the godlessness and because of the immorality, when there seems to be no political way out and there seems to be no social way out, we can be tempted to forget and hang our hands down in frustration and say, well, what the use? But God is saying, the words that go out of my mouth will not return void. but it will accomplish and it will prosper in the things whereunto I sent it. Now we ask ourselves a question, has God ever spoken anything concerning his intention to bless any nation upon the face of the earth? And the answer is yes. The Bible says that righteousness exalts a nation. When there is the practice of righteousness, when there is a promotion of righteousness, when there is an upholding of righteousness, when there is a pursuit of righteousness, God declares in his word, it will exalt that nation. And if this is one of the scriptures we can hold on to, we can hold on to that, the God's word. But what has happened is this, the nations of the earth have turned their backs upon God. And we have come to a point of believing that we can handle our own affairs. Now, I am still wanting to explain the fact that not because God has declared he wants to bless the nations, not because God says to Abraham, he will bless the nations of the earth, that they are automatically blessed. God has given us certain guidelines. He has given us certain rules. He has given us certain intentions of his. And God will not step out of those guidelines. It says that when a nation forgets God, it will be cast down. It will be pulled down. But when there's righteousness in the nation, when that nation practices the things that please God, God is under obligation by his word to release his blessing, to release his favor upon that nation. And therefore, Trinidad and Tobago, we need to return to God. We are not going to be blessed of God if we refuse to return and we insist upon our own ways. I don't need to tell you, beloved, we are in a dire strait. Our nation is at the crossroads. We are in a place where we don't know what will happen in our nation. We can't become worse than we are right now. I have often said it would be an insult to believe we can become worse than we really are right now. We have hit rock bottom. But there's a way out. You see, beloved, the way out is not by a politician. The way out is not by the way of some social program. The way out is the adherence to the word of God. The Bible says, they that know their God will be strong and will do great exploit. And I often talk about the people of Israel because why? Because God used that as a sample. God's dealing with the people of Israel is a sampling of how he will deal with the world. You know, one thing that God told Joshua after he succeeded Moses and he was settling down into the land of Canaan, it was, don't think that what you are going to enjoy is because you are better off than any other nation. Moses also reminded him in the book of Deuteronomy, it's not because you are stronger, matter of fact, he said, the nations among whom you dwell, they are much stronger than you. You had nothing. You had no vineyards. You had no houses. You had nothing. And therefore, you haven't become the successor. You haven't become blessed. It's not because you had a stronger army or a better economy or you had more up-to-date plans for irrigation. He said, no. You're going to occupy cities that you never built. You're going to take grape vineyards that you never planted. You're going to enjoy accommodation that you never structured. Why? Because your God has been the one who has fought for you. Your God has been the one who has upheld you. He wanted to impress upon them, it is not by might nor by power, but by the very spirit of the living God. And so, Trinidad and Tobago, we are going to reap the benefit of God if we will come to our senses and realize in the time when there's darkness in the land,
the time when we are up against a wall, the time when we have hit rock bottom, the time when we have come to a crossroad, that the way out of us, our dilemma, is turning back to God. And God told Israel that in chapter 55 and verse 7, he said, let the righteous forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return. That the answer, we have to forsake our way. For God declares, your ways are not my ways, neither are your thoughts my thoughts, says God. For the heavens are high above the earth, so are my ways above your ways, and my thoughts above your thoughts. And when we come to a point in our life of thinking that because we have technology, or we have the latest of this and that, that we can do without God, that we have all the answers, we are making a mistake. We are building our own grave, building our own walls of destruction. We must come to forsake our way. We must come to a point in our life when we realize we need God. We must break off our own way. God said, come now, come to me. For he says he is the way, he's the truth, he's the life. And God is saying to Israel, who had turned their back upon God, who had forsaken God, and because they were now settled in relative security, they thought that they don't need God. God said, come on, man, you got to forsake your way. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. What are the thoughts we have forsake? The thought that there is no God. You might not go and make that statement in the Woodford Square or in the marketplace. But when we live our lives as if we are God unto ourselves, when we live our lives like if we are a law unto ourselves, we are saying there is no God. When we think, well, we don't need God, we don't have time, and we have to look for some way to wriggle ourselves out of the tight spot, and think that we have all the answers, we fail to recognize the almightiness of God. We fail to recognize the sufficiency of God because we get the idea we can do it all by ourselves. And God is saying, the first thing we must do here is to forsake our way. Forsake means to leave it behind. Drop it off. Stop the confusion. Stop being confused in your own mind. Stop trying to wring your hand in frustration, asking yourself, what must I do? God said, forsake your way. Your way is not God's way. Your way is opposed many times, diametrically opposed to God's way. You see, because, beloved, we are finite and God is infinite. We don't have all the answers, but God has. With us, we are really in the realm of impossibility. But with God, there is no impossibility. Wouldn't it be a wonderful thing to say, God, you know better. You know the future. I cannot tell what will happen tomorrow morning. I could only surmise, given what things are, and if things continue as they are, I presume or I assume it might be thus and thus. But it's only an assumption. But God, you know about tomorrow. You see the future, God. You live in the future. You're the God from everlasting to everlasting. You are God. The tomorrows that have not come as yet, God, you have been there already. I don't know what will take place the next half an hour. But God, you know. You understand my thoughts are far off, says the word of God. Therefore, why must I have any difficulty entrusting my way unto a God like that? I can afford to relax myself. If I knew I can commit myself and confide myself in the hand of such a tremendous personality who knows my future. It was Job who declared, he knows the way that I take. When he couldn't understand why he was going through what he was going through, he said, he knows the way that I take. And when he has tried me, I'll come forth like pure gold. In all his suffering, whenever around him seemed to be just darkness, and there seemed to be no way out. And he was really confused, because until then it was never heard that a man who feared God could go through some horrible suffering and shame. And even his wise friends who came, they couldn't understand neither. They couldn't understand. But Joseph said, you know what happened? I'm going to stop trying to burst my mind. I'm going to stop trying to ogle my brain. He knows. That means God. He knows the way I take. He knows it. And when he has tried me, I will come forth. I will come forth. You know what you say? In spite of my dilemma, in spite of what I'm going through now, in spite of the darkness that seemed to engulf me, in spite of the hopelessness, in spite of the fact I've now come up against a wall, God knows my future. He knows what will take place tomorrow and next year and next month. He knows the way I take. And that is the wonderful news for Trinidad and Tobago. We must come to a point of entrusting our ways unto God. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. What are your thoughts? That God does not anymore have the answer. That God is no longer relevant. I remember in 1970, when we had that uprising in 1970. In those days, I lived in Siparia. And I forgot, I was actually, the country was in a real state. Folk were scared. Everybody had their ear glued to the radio. Matter of fact, it was such a national thing that if folk held up a taxi and there was no radio, they'll say, no, I'm not going with you. They wanted to make sure they're going in a car that had a radio. In those days, not every car had a radio. I remember I got into a taxi from Siparia to go to San Fernando. It is as clear as if it were last night in mine. And it was only 5 men in the car. And they were, for about the first quarter mile or so, about, there was total silence in the car. Then one man began to speak, and he said he had heard, he knew that the soldiers are up on the hill and this and so is taking place, and they are shelling the mountain and so on. And I mean, everybody was really scared in the car. And one guy said, afterwards, he said, you know something? The only person who can really save us out of this mess is Jesus Christ. Another guy said, Jesus Christ, man, you forget that now. And by the way, beloved, these men were not blaspheming. This was a serious matter. And one guy said, boy, I mean, you forget that now. He said, things are so bad that even though Jesus Christ were to come back here now, he himself would be so confused, he would not even know what to do. And he meant it. He had not been blasphemous or just trying to be funny. It was a tense moment. But he really believed that things were so bad that even Jesus would not have had the answer. And I thought it was time for me to actually speak up and say, gentlemen, in spite of what is happening, Jesus Christ is in control. These men can go so far and no further. I said, if we put our trust in God, with God, nothing shall be impossible. I said to them, Bible says, cast your way upon the Lord. He will sustain you. One fellow said, you're a preacher or what? I said, yeah, I'm a preacher. And he really said to me, he said, I'm feeling good now. It tells me from since then that people want to hear something as an answer. And when I understood and told him, this is from the Bible, it's not my philosophy, the guy said, I'm feeling good now. I said, yes, the Bible tells us that if we can think of God, cast our thoughts upon the Lord, and he will sustain you. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. We have to be thinking, beloved, that God is real. That God is God. He's stronger than men. The Bible says that the weakness of God is stronger than the strength of men. Then secondly, we have to forsake the thought that God does not see our actions. He sees you. You can do what you do under the darkness of night. You can do what you do in the cover of seclusion. God sees you. The Bible declared in Luke chapter 12 and verse 2, there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed, neither hid that shall not be made known. These corrupt government ministers think they have done their trade for the past 5 years and thought that nobody saw them, God saw them, and now the mark has begun to burst. And there's yet more to come. You better hold on to your seat. There's more to come. There's more to come. We are in more trouble than you ever thought we are in. Because these men with their corrupt ways, who they think they're smart, and they can use the cover of legality. But the same legality has now turned back to slap them in the face. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. You can do nothing, beloved, that God doesn't see you. Oh, you might quote legality. A man is presumed innocent until found guilty. And you'll say, oh, bring your evidence. Bring your evidence. People might not have evidence. But beloved, you are not guilty because there's evidence. You are guilty because you have done something wrong. And we may never be able to find a legal thing to go on a court of law. But that doesn't make you innocent. For the time you commit a wrong, you are innocent. I mean, you're guilty, rather, for the time you commit a wrong. And we hide under logistics of legality and this and that. And think you can get away. Well, you can get it from man. You may get away from the justice system. But you will not get away from God. For God declared that there's nothing covered that shall not be known, neither hid that shall not be made known. And God is now bringing, he's moving the cover. He's moving the blanket. He's moving the screen. And the full blast of the ugliness of sin and corruption have begun now to be exposed. And it only has just begun. There's more to come. Then thirdly, what thoughts are we going to forsake? We forsake the thought that God is not concerned about us. That the guy said in 1970, Jesus is so busy. If he came back here, he would know. Beloved, God is concerned about you. You got to think of that. He is concerned about you. A young woman named Hagar, having been cast out in the desert, nowhere to go, no family, having nothing to hold on to, having no future, and thinking that the less that could happen to her is her dying. And then why so dear crying? She is pregnant. She is expecting a child. There is no future. The world has lost a bottom. And as she was there crying, heard a voice, Hagar. When she looked around, the Lord appeared to her by the means of an angel. And the Lord called her by her name and said, Hagar, return to your mistress Sarah. And then Hagar says something that is so very, very good. He says, thou, Lord, seest me. In other words, in this place of nowhere, in this place of where there is no return, you mean that you are seeing me? In this place of isolation, you, God, see me? Yes, beloved, God sees you. When you are down in the dumps, when you have nowhere to go, nowhere to hide, when there are no caves to hide yourself in, God sees you. When you're abandoned, God sees you. When you are forsaken, God sees you. And we must understand in Trinidad and Tobago, God sees all the wrongs that are taking place. And God sees the people who are called by his name. And God will protect and take care of his own. God sees you. And that's why we can't afford to stop praying. We can't be caught up in the confusion that there's no way out. The people that know their God, we are told, to be strong and shall do exploits. And this is the call for our nation to return to God, forsake our ways. And Jesus Christ says, him who comes unto me, I will in no wise cast out. He said, come unto me, and I will give you rest. Will you come to him now? God is not looking for a mass coming. He looks for every person individually, one by one by one. And you today, as an individual, have you returned to God as yet? Have you surrendered your life to God? If not, you can do so now, right now. In the closing moment of this message, you can do so because Jesus says, come unto me, and he who comes to me, I will in wise cast out. I pray God will do so right now. And if you do that, I want to hear from you. Call me at this number, 675-1679. The office is open. It will be left on my desk, and when I come in, I will definitely call you right away. We want to invite you to join us Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday of this week. We have been in the time of prayer and fasting until the month of March. We began last month. And so 3 days of the week we fast, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And in the night of those 3 days, we have a time of teaching. We are teaching about prayer, how to build an effective prayer life. You're going to enjoy it. Until next Monday, I want to invite you to join me next Sunday for a time of praise and worship at 8 o'clock for Bible Sunday school time, at 9 o'clock for a time of worship and the spoken word. You are going to be blessed. My name is Elmore Anthony. I'm the pastor of Rhema Ministries of number 1 Sawmill Avenue, just off the eastern main room in Baratario. God bless you. Thanks for listening. And tell your friends that the nation blessed of God is on the air again, and we are now here to stay. Have a wonderful week, and may God bless you real good.